Well, thank you for your welcome, and thanks, John, for this opportunity to speak. As John said, I'm a mathematician. I don't have a book for you today, but there are a couple of articles, and they're freely available online, or at least the second one will be soon. The first one already is. So, I work with a group of historians and a systems biologist, in fact, and the great thing about our strange interdisciplinary collaboration is that, because I love naval history, military history, and they love trying to understand the quantification of certain aspects of history where that's necessary, we actually get on well with each other. So liking each other's stuff is the most important thing, really. Now, in order to set up the background for the Battle of the Dogger Bank, which was fought between battle cruisers in 1915, I need to give you some of the naval background. And I'm very conscious here that many of you are the experts on this, not me. But when I was a young mathematician, I was told never to underestimate how much pleasure an audience gets from being told things it already knows. So in that spirit, I hope to spend the first 10 minutes or so telling you things that will be very unsurprising to you. So if we take the 50 years before the Battle of Dogger Bank, as you know, it was a period of unparalleled, perhaps, technical development and change without many opportunities to test the results of all those technical changes. So, no.
Turn it on, the top right.
Yes. Okay. So, following the era of oak-built warships, we all know that the first couple of ironclads appeared around 1860, but they still look very much to the modern eye as the earlier wooden warships did. A couple of years later, well, you take the rather lovely frigate Merrimack and you turn it into that, the Virginia. And as we all know, what results is a standoff, effectively, in which neither ship is well able to damage the other. So armour has the ascendancy over guns at that particular point. And because of this supremacy of the defensive, with new iron armour, you had to think of something else to do. And we had a return, briefly, to the techniques of ramming, indeed. The affondatore, the sinker, was one of the ships at the Battle of Lissa in 1866, where the apparent lesson was that ironclad ships could get in close and could sink through ramming. But actually the story is not quite as simple as that, because the guns at the time, well, the British still preferred to use a muzzle-loading rifle, and the point is that without the breech mechanism you get an immensely strong gun, and although armour progressed, so that we had compound armour in which layers of wood and iron were alternated, in fact the British muzzle-loading rifle could certainly penetrate the compound armour. So although both guns and armour were developing, it's not absolutely clear that the defensive is always in the ascendancy. But we didn't really have tests after the Battle of Lissa. Of course, just to throw in a wild card here, we have the invention of the torpedo in the late 1860s. And I guess the sort of type of ship which is typical of the late 19th century is a battleship like HMS Victoria, in which what you have is mixed armament, mixed guns. So you see turret guns there, just one turret, and then lots of casement guns here. And of course, nobody really knew what ranges battles would be fought at. You had a history of battles being fought at very close ranges. You expected that the greatest damage could be done at close ranges, and you could put greater weight of metal on the enemy with those smaller guns very often. If anybody's interested in the development, the article which I like on that is by Karl Lautenschläger in International Security from 30 years ago. And he has a nice summary of the development of the various weapons and defences against them through that period. Okay, so let's take ourselves to the beginning of the 20th century and the Battle of Tsushima between a Russian fleet, which had just steamed a very long distance, and a very well-trained and effective Japanese fleet. The Japanese won. Bringing things home a little bit, at that time, Commander Bradley Fisk, one of the great figures in the US Navy, wrote a little article in the Naval Institute Proceedings, Why Togo Won. And essentially, he says, Japanese fleet handling was better, Japanese gunnery was better than the Russian. Right, where had we got to in 1905? Well, we had the big gun, and armour had made very rapid progress. We had Krupp's cemented armour, so this is where you take steel and you treat the outside very differently from the inside. You may treat it with carbon, or even just by blowing carbon dioxide over it, and you create a much more effective hardened armour. And the third thing that was a really significant technological development at that time was the possibility of replacing reciprocal engines with the steam turbine. So clearly, from the point of view of fundamental engineering, if you're trying to create rotary motion, then a rotary system is likely to be more powerful if you can get it right. And as is common knowledge, in this room at least, the idea of putting them together in a single ship, well, came from various places, Italy originally, but the first ship to be built was HMS Dreadnought. So what you had there is a combination of big guns only, turbine propulsion, and an appropriate amount of armour. And this was all part of John Fisher's revolution in the Royal Navy. But there was a second idea, which was that perhaps speed could be defence. And I guess the reason I put the three words at the bottom there is because all the careful people at the time, and people afterwards, such as the British Commander Jellicoe, made the point that what you really have in building a battleship is a choice in a certain tonnage of what you put into it, guns or propulsion or armour. If you put more of one, you have to put in less of one of the others. The battle cruiser, the idea was to have the big guns, to have excellent propulsion, giving the ship great speed, but to be rather light on armour. So a ship like that could very effectively hunt down merchant raiders and raiding cruisers around the world. It's very good for a maritime empire. The ship looks very similar to Dreadnought, but of course what is hidden there is that the armour is very thin, something like 4 inches as opposed to 10 inches or more for Dreadnought battleships. Now, was it intended that this kind of ship should be used in the battle line? Well, it's actually never quite clear. And this term battle cruiser is really a later one. At the time, we would have called this an armoured cruiser, which of course has its own irony. But given that it looks so much like a battleship, that seems like a very naive point, but that does, it seems, affect people's minds and the willingness to put such ships into the battle line. The first time these battle cruisers were used was to do the job for which they were intended. So British light forces suffered a defeat off Coronel, just west of Southern America, in autumn of 1914, and battle cruisers were dispatched to destroy the German raiders, which they did. That was, they were a bit lucky, actually. The Germans only had 8-inch guns, but there was one 8-inch shell which lodged very close to one of the British battlecruiser's vitals. And it might have gone differently, but we didn't do a study of that battle. What we did instead was to have a think about the first big clash of dreadnoughts, by which I mean all big gunships, which happened to be between battle cruisers at the beginning of January 1915. So if you recall the situation in the North Sea in the First World War, the crucial thing for Britain was to blockade Germany. Unlike 100 years earlier, this was done not through a close blockade, but through the stationing of the Grand Fleet, all of the British big ships, in various bases on the west side of the North Sea. And if you're a German, then from the German point of view, of course, the British Isles look like a great big breakwater across your access to the world, which is very much how they were used. The German intention was, with the Tirpitz's notion of the Risikoflotte, the risk fleet, to attempt to try to get down to something like numerical parity by breaking off a portion of the British fleet at a point where the Germans had superiority, had advantage of concentration, and destroying it. And the British politically had a rather difficult job to do because, of course, they knew that that was exactly what they had to avoid. And what the Germans tended to do was to raid East Coast towns in a way that created, British East Coast towns, in a way that created outrage in the British popular press and a lot of popular pressure on the Royal Navy to do something. But of course, doing something by dispatching a partial force was always going to be rather dangerous. Anyway, to cut the long story short, the first big clash here is between five British battle cruisers, so dreadnought battle cruisers, and, well, three German battle cruisers. And this ship, Blücher, so all these ships would have been called armoured cruisers at the time, Blücher was actually the German response to what they understood to be building when Britain was building Invincible, the first battle cruiser. And Blücher was probably, I think, well, even the Germans at the time regard it in retrospect as having been misconceived. It had 8-inch guns, not bad armour, but slightly lower speed than the battle cruisers, and many people on both sides thought that Blücher was unfitted to be in a line of battle cruisers. So this is a rather simple battle for us. It's just two lines going pretty much in one direction and slogging it out. You see, the potential complexity of the situation is that it's fleet geometry and fleet tactics determining that geometry that determines the calculus of damage on the two sides. And at the later Battle of Jutland, that issue becomes very complex. So the second paper in our series is about Jutland, but I'm not going to try and talk about that today. The Battle of the Dogger Bank really was a battle between two battle lines. It started in the early morning. Some of the big British worries were about a battle starting far over in the east of the North Sea late in the day, because the worry then would be that British ships would be damaged and not be recovered, whereas German ships would be recovered safely. But this was different. This was on the Dogger Bank, which is a fishing ground towards the British coast, or slightly closer to the British coast, and it started early in the day. And the battle cruisers engaged just before 9 o'clock. Well, at 9:43, the German battlecruiser Seydlitz was damaged. She had a flash fire. So I'll talk a little bit more about ammunition handling later on. But you could argue that the irony in that was that it enabled the Germans to understand the dangers that they faced from flash fire. The British did not have a similar flash fire at Dogger Bank. The flagship Lion was hit. There's an artist's impression of Lion at Dogger Bank. In fact, she was hit many times without anything catastrophic happening. Okay, let me come. I should have put in the big event at the battle, really, was that Lion, having been hit, she ended up having to haul out of the line. But before doing so, she put up two signals to the other British battle cruisers, which were intended effectively to say to the rest of the line, you go on, carry on fighting the German line. And the two signals were something like engage the enemy's rear and course northeast. But the trouble is they were understood together as one signal and understood as saying engage the enemy to the northeast, which was Blücher only. And what happened is that instead of carrying on with the battle as it was being fought at that time, the British ships concentrated on poor Blücher, which took a large number of hits. And there's a propaganda picture, actually, of stern British sailors looking on as the beastly Hun is sunk. That's taken from this, the children's story of the war, the 1915. Only by sheer good luck did any of the German ships escape. Class-based society, I'd have to parody. That was the general view. It was the propaganda view, but it wasn't just the propaganda view. Then Commander Reginald... Oh, I've got to say his name. It's a little bit unfair to do it. Reginald Aylmer Ranfurly Plunkett Ernley Earl Drax. You don't need a title if you've got a long enough name for the English aristocracy. Although he only took some of those names later for other reasons. Anyway. Commander Drax, on the staff of the British Commander Beatty at Dogger Bank, said, well, Something I neglected to mention was that the second ship in the British line fired on the first ship in the German line because of a misunderstanding, really, about, fleet battle orders, which meant that the second ship in the German line was unfired on for a while, and Drax thought this was the problem. So, but for Tiger's misdirection of fire, we certainly should have sunk the greater part of the enemy's squadron. And that, I think, was the common view. We've spent some time in the archives. We've come across that view several times. It wasn't universal, as we'll see. But it is a view that's come down to the modern day for some naval historians, and even people writing about fleet tactics, that the British lost an opportunity to win a decisive victory over the German battle cruisers. So that's the idea we want to test. But just before we get to that, this lesson that the battle cruiser was a wonderful ship, only Blücher was sunk, and Blücher was an earlier version of the concept, really, not a full battle cruiser. This idea that the battle cruiser was vindicated by Dogger Bank found its way into the United States. So there are a couple of Naval Institute Proceedings articles from 1915 which say exactly that. There's a plea for the battle cruiser by a constructor, and there's the arrival of the battle cruiser. The kind of things they say are, you know, the fighting capacity of the battle cruiser is such that its employment in future fleet engagements, so remember, not just as a destroyer of commerce raiders, but employment in fleet engagements is a certainty. We've just seen an engagement between squadrons of battle cruisers. And more hyperbolically, the battle cruiser is mistress of the sea. I'm not going to try and do an American accent for that. But certainly that view was common in the Allied navies. Okay, so let's try and test it. Now, I'm not going to show you any equations anywhere. And when operations researchers or analysts try to present a mathematical model, you should never trust them. Treat them as if you're an engineer who wants to know how the cogs in the black box, which is the model, work. And you have every right to question everything right back to how the cogs fit together. And that's the spirit in which I'm going to approach what we're going to do next. So there's the black box in the middle. It's not very black. The model. Some scheme by which the parameters, the numbers that determine the conditions of battle, so shell calibers, damage effects, fire effects, everything in gaming, will cause an outcome. So as John said, I'm spending a lot of time in the archives at the moment, and you can pretty much draw a distinction between the parameters, so all of the numbers that feed into the game, and then the rules of the game by which damage is caused or outcomes are reached. And actually there's quite a lot of confusion in the War College archives over the rules of the game in the period I'm looking at, from 24 through to 46. Which I can explain if anybody's interested later, but I won't do that now. So from our model, we hope to get an outcome, and I've written a spray of arrows there because this model might have some randomness in it. War certainly has some randomness in it. So we can get an outcome. We can get many outcomes if we have a random model. And then what we've got to do is to compare the outcomes of the model with the truth. And this is where the word Bayesian comes in. So essentially, at its simplest, we go in with some prejudices. Well, that's a bit harsh, calling them prejudices. In Bayesian language, we call them priors, prior values of the parameters. We see what outcome the model produces. We compare it with reality, and then we go back and adjust our ideas accordingly. And this is is rather in contrast to traditional what is called frequentist statistics, and people who believe in a Bayesian approach have been true believers over the last 30 years, and I think largely they've pretty much won the battle. If you have a background certainly in the sciences rather than in traditional statistics, it's a very natural point of view, because consider the sort of thing that might happen. Suppose that you're doing something like a medical trial. You've got a number of different outcomes. Those are the true outcomes, and they're a little bit different from what you were expecting, given the parameters. Well, you can adjust the parameters. And this is a very good tool for doing what Kuhn called normal science. So nothing very revolutionary going on. You're just trying to get a very precise idea of what the correct parameters are. You started out with an idea based on all of your prior experience and knowledge beforehand, but then you adjusted it a little in the light of the true outcome. Well, back to a single outcome, which you would get, for example, if the model is deterministic. But what about a situation, as in history, where we only have one set of realized events? We can't run history over and over again and thereby test what the probabilities were of different historical events actually happening. Well, nevertheless, you can use a Bayesian approach in exactly the same way to adjust the parameters a little. Of course, I've drawn a true outcome there a bit off center. You've got less certainty perhaps than you had if you had a wide distribution of many, many replications of your trial, but nevertheless, you can do something. The name of this procedure is Bayesian computation, or approximate Bayesian computation. That word approximate is actually slightly misleading. It's not really more or less approximate than earlier forms of Bayesian computation. The big revolutionary thing was that it's called, well, Bayesian computation without likelihoods. And just let me digress a little bit on the terminology. Probabilists and statisticians use the word probability to describe, okay, what's the chance of a coin that I toss coming up heads? They use the word likelihood slightly differently. Now, in everyday parlance, it means pretty much the same thing. But if probability runs from this way to that, says given the parameters, what is the probability of that outcome? Likelihood is used to run the opposite way. So given the outcomes, what is the likelihood of certain parameters? And of course, the situation in which this particular issue really bites hard is in the law, actually. If you think of court cases, so in Britain there are famous court cases concerning multiple cot deaths in the same family. There was actually a ruling in Britain, I think, that effectively said something that outraged all of us, that said Bayesian thinking is too hard for juries. The trouble is, it's the right way of thinking about the situation. So that effectively amounts to saying that the correct way of arriving at the truth is too hard for juries. So what you do is on the right, well, there are plenty of articles you can read with no equations in them, which are good reads on this subject. The stuff on the right there in the legal context is evidence. Assorted circumstantial evidence, blood groups, genetic evidence, and so on. And the parameters might include simple categorical things like guilty or innocent. Anyway, right, so this is called approximate Bayesian computation because in the fashioned models, until about 15 years ago, you always had a very precise mathematical way of writing down the distribution, the likely distribution of the parameters. And it was always very hard to do in a case where the model was a bit more complex. You know, the black box had a lot of strange stuff going on inside it, and it was hard to run backwards. But there was a groundbreaking paper about 12, 13 years ago, Tavare et al., who called it... the term in modern use is approximate Bayesian computation. Essentially, it means that whenever you've got a half-decent model and some parameters, you can try and run this procedure. Okay, what happens if the true outcome is way off what you expected? What are we going to do if that happens? Well, you can't just adjust the parameters a bit. You've really got to say one of three things has happened. Something is wrong. Either the model is wrong, that's perfectly possible. So all of us then have to really delve into the cogs in the black box and work out whether or not they're telling us the right thing, or approximately the right thing, or if there's some fundamental flaw. Or it could be that the parameters are just very, very wrong. You've missed some parameters. some things that just change fundamentally what you should have been doing, or something unlikely has happened. Isn't that possible? Unlikely things do happen. Now, at this point, of course, if you're a historian, well, actually, no. If you're a historian, maybe you begin to smell, well, how on earth do we tell whether something unlikely has happened? So the historian's role is really to understand why things did unfold as they did, why events unfolded as they did. On the other hand, of course, if you're a historian, you don't believe that everything was inevitable, or else history is just one damn thing after another. So we'll bear that in mind as we go through, and I'll make some comments about historical methodology at the end. But for the moment, let's go and have a look at the model and the parameters and what happened at Dogger Bank. So the model, usually called the Lanchester model. Lanchester in Britain wrote his model down just before the First World War in some articles in Engineering magazine. But in classified work for the US Navy, Chase had written it down in 1902. Fisk had written down effectively the same model in 1905. And the way to characterize the difference is that whereas Lanchester and Fisk were using calculus, so if you never did any calculus, that's fine, Fisk used what we would nowadays call spreadsheets. So he wrote down tables, but just think of it as doing your sums on spreadsheets rather than having the sophistication of calculus at your disposal. Osipov in Russia was probably working early during the First World War, and then there's another character I hadn't known about to whom Wayne Hughes alerted me, Antoine Baudry in France in 1910. And the point about this is that these ideas were coming out absolutely everywhere. It was very much part of the spirit of the age was to, in early operations research, was to try to understand this point, which at its simplest is just that a force causes damage in proportion to its numbers and not in proportion to the enemy's numbers. So when would that be true? Well, in the case of dreadnought battleships, on the whole, you expect each gun to be that's within range to be hitting. Each gun has a target. Each ship usually has a single ship as an opposing target. And in order to make sure that the force causes damage in proportion to its own numbers, but not in proportion to enemy numbers, what you really need is a target-rich environment, as perceived by both sides, but one in which, if you miss your target, you're not going to hit something else instead. Because if that were true, there would be a density effect. And the general view is that, in all the history of warfare, this is the one circumstance in which that is probably and is typically true. So that's just weight of opinion. We've got to say something about what these terms mean. Numbers are of the units which stand or fall together. So they might be guns, they might be turrets, they might be ships. Fisk thought that the correct unit was turrets, and if a turret can be destroyed without sinking a ship, that's certainly true. If there's a danger that one hit can destroy the whole ship, then of course the unit is the ship. Well, is it true? If we're actually looking for some evidence, at the time I didn't perhaps appreciate the significance of these documents. I was in the British National Archives at Kew looking through other things, but there was a great big tome, a couple hundred pages, about gunnery practices in the Grand Fleet during the First World War. This was actually all put together, I think, just after the war in 1819. And what they were trying to do was effectively to work out whether or not that statement, force causes damage in proportion to its numbers, is true or not. And what they did was look back at all the exercises they've done and try and look at the effects of concentration, of ship concentrations of 2-1, 3-1, 4-1. And usually that is in individual engagements, two ships against one, three against one, four against one. And of course the danger was that spotting would be confused. So you would mistake the shell smashers of another ship for your own, and so full benefit of concentration would not be achieved. But on the whole, it was pretty well achieved, and they decided that thereafter, in exercises, putting all things together, a ship concentration of 2-1 indeed should stand. 3:1 and 4:1, there was some danger of confusion, and they were given multipliers of 2.5 and 3 for future exercises. But actually, that's ample to justify the use of our bold-faced assumption there, because concentrations of greater than 2:1 were rather unusual. They did happen, but if 2:1 is okay, and 3:1 and 4:1 still give you something better than 2:1, then as a baseline assumption, this assumption is fine. So what went into our model, it's a random, a probabilistic model, is simply to say that each turret firing has a certain probability of hitting, which of course is a function of the amount of practice the ship has had, the range, the target, the armour, all of this sort of stuff. What about the parameters? Well, the reason we're able to do something here, really, is because we have for the parameters, not just... So, okay, a lot of the parameters are more or less fixed, but many aren't. We have data from the earlier engagement off the Falkland Islands, but we also have data from the later and much larger Battle of Jutland. And to the extent to which ships and conditions were the same at Jutland as at Dogger Bank, that's a reasonable thing to do. Well, what are we talking about? We're talking about shells, ships, guns, armour, gunnery practice, because British battle cruiser shooting was awful. But above all, flash fire. So, in that body of doctrine before the First World War, there was a sort of tension between firing fast and firing accurately. And as you know, so you see the turret on top of the ship, but you have the magazine deep in the ship and various handling chambers and means by which flash fire can be prevented from passing from the turret down through to the magazines. But it's commonly accepted that all of those mechanisms to stop flash fire spreading were not implemented properly. And further, that in order to achieve rapidity of fire, crews were storing charges in the various handling chambers where they shouldn't have been storing them. And this was certainly true on the British side, and probably true for the Germans as well. Certainly true before Dogger Bank, and we've already said that Seydlitz had a flash fire which caused the Germans to become much stricter in their handling procedures before Jutland, because they saw the danger of this flash fire. The British didn't get that kind of lesson at Dogger Bank. And on the British side, probably flash procedures did not change much in the intervening period. The crucial paper for me here, the one that best sums the situation up, is Nicholas Lambert. That's a reference to the British battlecruiser commander Beatty's comment to the captain of his flagship at Jutland later on, when the British battlecruisers were blowing up. After the first two, he said, "There seems to be something wrong with our bloody ships today, or our bloody system." And of course, you can argue that both were true. In terms of the lessons learned from Dogger Bank, what we want to know is if there were changes in flash discipline between Dogger Bank and Jutland. And on the one hand, we have this statement here: a mistake was made in firing too slowly during the earlier stages. Rapidity of fire is essential. Yeah, actually, well, the correct lesson would have been that gunnery practice is essential and the British battlecruiser should have been hitting more accurately. But we're not interested in that point at this stage. We're interested in whether or not, as a result of comments like that, flash discipline actually got worse on the British side. But in the same document, Ernie Chatfield, captain of Lion, says, "Yes, but plunging fire is a great danger to ammunition anywhere between decks. Lids of powder cases should not be removed faster than necessary." And he's falling between two stools, really. There's an Admiralty memorandum of February 1915 after Dogger Bank, which does urge better flash discipline. They don't know what happened to Seydlitz, but it's clearly it feels like a lesson from Dogger Bank, although it's not explicitly so. And Lambert says that actually it was probably not widely acted upon. So it's hard to know. It's not clear in which direction the lessons of Dogger Bank run for the British as regards flash discipline, and there's nothing at all in the lessons learned. So I guess in our 3 points model or parameters or something unlikely happened, we felt we'd done our due diligence on the flash discipline, and we don't have a clear argument that flash discipline got worse between Dogger Bank and Jutland. There's one other nice little thing in the lessons learned. I mean, the complacency of this is appalling. I'll do that accent again. German shell for incendiary effect and damage to personnel are far inferior to ours. Their only good quality lies in armour penetration and damage to material. These sailors at battle stations, armour penetration and damage to material look quite fundamental to me. As a civilian, I wouldn't know. I mean, as for incendiary effects, you know, there are issues with how much crucial stuff is led around outside the armour. Well, anyway. Okay, so before I just cut to the results, let me state again this buzzword, approximate Bayesian computation, ABC. It wasn't me who wrote the simulation, it was my colleague Jamie Wood, who's a systems biologist most of the time, that's his day job. He writes simulations of swarms of this and flocks of that and bacteria doing this and so on. He's basically the go-to simulation writer for the biology department in my university. And he makes the point that for 12 years now we've had this very standardized methodology. We have a tool and everybody knows what tool you're using. So if I say I hit it with something, if I say I hit it with a hammer, you know pretty much what I'm talking about, as long as it's not a sledgehammer or a lump hammer. In the same way, we have a very standardized tool. It is in some sense optimal computationally, although that's perhaps of less interest to you. But above all, what it does is to explore all of the parameter space for its capacity to reproduce real results. And in a sense, there's a nice comment from Drax, actually, in a 1920 document talking about the value of wargaming, which is a very appropriate thing to talk about here. And he says, well, okay, you know, what you can do once in a fleet exercise, a fleet problem, you can do several times a day on the gaming board. These must have been quite quick games. And do them 20 times a month. Well, yes, but you don't really explore every counterintuitive possibility for the parameters until you get up to millions and tens of millions of war games, and that's what we're really doing. If you do Bayesian computation, you're doing a fairly simple war game, but you're doing it 10 to the 6, 7 at least times. And the point of doing that is that if there are a lot of parameters, there's a lot of the parameter space to explore. You've really got to wander around it quite a lot to work out what's going on. And you explore it thoroughly and you decide where could possibly explain what you observe. Okay, so here are the results. What we have here are two distributions. This is what we think the probabilities were of what would have happened at Dogger Bank, and this is up to the point of the signals which caused the British battlecruisers to disengage from the rest of the German line and concentrate on Blücher, because what happened after that point is not typical of what had happened before. And you can see that we conclude that actually what happened was fairly typical. You've got 7 hits on German ships, and we think there should have been about 6. You have, 22 hits on British ships, and we think that about 24 would have been typical, with quite a big distribution. The striking thing about that plot is that you should have expected 3 times as many hits on British ships as hits on German ships. This was Beatty's fault, really. The British battleships in Scarpa Flow had a lot of space, and under Jellicoe they practiced their gunnery hard, and later at Jutland their gunnery was pretty good. But Beatty was based in the much narrower Firth of Forth at Rosyth, and I don't think it's unfair to say that he did seem to be more interested in parties and hunting than he was in organising gunnery practice. I think that really is fair. Now, of course, it's very hard to organise gunnery practice in the Firth of Forth. You've got to go out into the open sea, and it would have been difficult. In an attempt to improve British battlecruiser gunnery practice, what happened was that individual squadrons of battlecruisers were detached to join the Grand Fleet at Scarpa Flow for gunnery practice. And in fact, that happened just before the Battle of Jutland later on, and the shooting of that particular squadron improved enormously. Anyway, so the hits are fairly typical. If you think the unit is the turret, well, the Germans lost two turrets, and we can see they got pretty unlucky, actually, there. They, you know, the median would have been to lose no turrets. For the British, well, they should have expected to lose turrets, and indeed they did lose two. But the more significant thing is in ships lost. So the Germans there have lost no ships. That's because at that stage Blücher had not been lost. The point is they lost no ships during the 3 hours of the main battle between the lines of the battle cruisers. The British lost no ships, but they very definitely got lucky, we think. So you could say, well, this is perhaps over-quantifying, isn't it, to say that between 35, the British had a 35 to 40% chance of losing no ships. Well, no, it's not. So I'm going to get defensive as a mathematician now, you see. There's a very nice article by Joss Epstein at Santa Fe called Why Model? If anybody's interested, he kind of makes the point that, well, one of his points is that if you claim that you don't have a quantified model, well, probably you do implicitly, because if somebody asks you to take a bet, you would be willing to do so. You just haven't laid the bones of your model bare in such a way that they can be looked at carefully. In this case, we think we can quantify, and we say that the British had just below a 40% chance of getting away without ships lost during that first phase of the engagement. Much more likely was that they would have lost one, or with nearly a 20% chance, two ships, or even more. So I said earlier that the general British view was that the Germans had had a lucky escape, but that wasn't everybody's view. This chap, who is a lieutenant on Tiger, the second ship in the line, which was hit nothing like as much as Lion, said we were okay, so I don't know what his class background was, and so what his accent should be. I'll just say we were marvellously lucky to escape as we did, as their shooting was damned good. Strange that, you know, that two people and the two leading ships could come to such diametrically opposed conclusions on the basis of their observations of the battle. And we say that essentially the British got lucky. At its very simplest, it's that, well, given that the British lost three battle cruisers at Jutland a year and a half later to flash fire, they were very lucky not to lose ships at Dogger Bank. And that's basically the point. The question is whether or not we've tested that properly. So the idea was to use Bayesian computation to really explore that inference and decide whether it was reasonable. And I think we can go to say as far as to say that they would almost certainly have done so had the action not been truncated. So as I say, they had something like only a one-third chance, a bit more, say 40% chance of not losing ships by the time the action was truncated. If the action had continued for same again, well, square that, the chances of their not losing a ship then would have been more like a tenth. Okay, so now let me try and say something more generally about historical methodology. So since we wrote the paper, in fact, I've had many more discussions with academic historians. And the academic historians in the audience can tell me whether or not they'd agree. But if I try to get the historical endeavour down to its simplest, and I say, well, what we want to do is to understand why did events unfold as they did. And as I said earlier, there's this slight tension between, on the one hand, you don't want to engage in speculation. On the other hand, if history is not to be inevitable, one thing after another, then, you know, if it were, then there wouldn't be anything to explain. Well, I guess the lesson from what I've just tried to tell you is that to say, well, perhaps someone got lucky, is no longer counsel of despair, necessarily, for a historian. So I'm claiming that there's a new tool in the historian's toolbox. I think we've written the first paper on this. Approximate Bayesian computation has sort of been rolling out, encroaching on various disciplines. It's used in archaeology now to try to decide whether or not, on the basis of archaeological finds, distributions, for example, of finds, events happened as they did. So, for instance, I gave a seminar on this at Oxford, and Hugh Strachan suggested that, well, I live in York, there's lots of, most of the battles on English soil seem to have happened around York. There are lots of obsessive collectors of archaeological finds and geographic information systems mapping battlefield finds now. Maybe we can go back and have a careful look at where exactly the Battle of Fulford happened, or what exactly was the effects of Cromwell's second charge at Marston Moor, that kind of thing. Anyway, there's a red rag for bull. We made the mistake of framing the paper in terms of counterfactual history, which upsets historians a lot. So that's why I put it in red. Michael Howard, grown-up historians don't waste time on counterfactuals. Because, you know, if you look at the books on counterfactual history, there's a lot of piling supposition on supposition, and you think, well, what have we actually learned by the time we've got two suppositions away from reality? And in precisely such a book, my namesake Neil Ferguson plaintively says, how exactly are we to distinguish probable unrealised alternatives from improbable ones, if you're playing the counterfactual history game? And he doesn't stay for an answer. But if you are actually, so, you know, I showed you that distribution of British ships lost. We had the distribution was the outcome, and the true outcome was one of those things. So, you know, 38% chance of no ships lost, 62% chance of at least one ship lost. So for us, it's the same question as saying, how exactly are we to distinguish probable real events from improbable ones? And if we reframe it like that, then I hope the historians can be a bit happier. Because we would say that, okay, when history is quantifiable, doesn't happen very often, not wildly ramified, so not supposition on supposition and all sorts of unquantifiable counterfactuals, can be modelled. It's not very often that you have a clear model with a good rationale for why things happen. And the parameters accurately determined. In our case, we have really good information on the parameters from the later battle at Jutland, which gives us a lot more. And, well, okay, perhaps we are back to Council of Despair. Almost never, then. The reason we picked Doggerbank was precisely because we could do this game there. It's rather rare, but perhaps I just haven't thought of the circumstances in which it might apply elsewhere. Then the answer is approximate Bayesian computation. So, just to pick one of my favourite sentences by my historian collaborator Chris Price, and this shows why it is that he wants to work with mathematicians and systems biologists, you see. And this is pretty much his view. The course of history is complex, contingent, and develops within an envelope of probabilities surrounding the historical narrative. It has to. I think it's a good sentence, but maybe that shows why I like historians, that I quite like purple sentences. As we said, if you want to understand why things happen, we claim that you do have to at least acknowledge the possibility of other things having happened. I guess we would say that if you're going to avoid the various causation fallacies, post hoc fallacy, others, then the mindset required by the historian is precisely that of Bayesian probability. To understand historical actors' implicit prior estimates of chances, how these changed as events unfolded, and how they compare with real probabilities, not just realised events. And in fact, at Christmas I was given three copies by my extended family of Tetlock and Gardner's Super Forecasting, the pop psych book of last year, so they obviously knew what I would enjoy reading. so I've been giving the others away recently. Essentially, actually, let me take a quick show of hands. Anybody read Tetlock and Gardner? No? Oh, you should. It's very good. So, I have no talk for them. Tetlock runs a project called the Good Judgment Project. And the idea, this is a US intelligence idea, was to try to see if the normal guy on the street, actually not quite the normal guy on the street, but if members of the public were better at forecasting events than their intelligence analysts. So, for example, you can sign up, do it in 10 minutes, for their geostrategic game, where you've got to forecast things like, you know, will there be an election in Syria by the end of the year? Will the price of oil drop below $10 a barrel by the end of the year? Stuff like that. And the book goes into great detail about the mindset required to create good forecasts. Actually, I think they missed the crucial thing, which is time. I signed up for it. I really fancied doing it, but it would take me about an hour on the web for every individual question, quantifying every aspect of it to try to write down something reasonable, and I just don't have the time, which is a shame. But That particular mindset certainly acknowledges that unlikely things do happen. Just because you make a forecast that turns out to be wrong doesn't mean you were wrong. The English boxer Chris Eubank, this very sort of intellectual middleweight boxer, he was briefly world champion 20 odd years ago. I remember very much liking an interview, and he said he thought, "I'm a really good bet for this fight, and even if I lose, I will still have been a good bet for this fight." Well, so the Bayesian would then say, "Yeah, but whatever our prior probabilities were, once you've actually lost it, we'll probably modify those a bit." But of course, the same question arises. Would you modify them a bit? Mm-hmm. How much would you modify them? How strong were your priors, your prior view about Eubank's abilities before the fight? And these kind of mindsets, Tetlock and Gardner calls them, they call them the fox versus the hedgehog. The hedgehog who knows one big thing as opposed to the fox who learns lots of little things. In the later story of the Battle of Jutland, I think we would say that Beatty was more of a hedgehog. The one big thing he knew was the Nelsonian view of engage the enemy more closely. Jellicoe, the commander of the battleships of the Grand Fleet, was much more of a fox. And from everything that he does, you can see him weighing probabilities, trying to maximize the chances. And essentially, the game at Jutland, I'm not going to give a Jutland talk now, but the game of Jutland is for Jellicoe to try to create as much certainty as he can from the situation as it unfolds of a strategic victory, even at the expense of a tactical victory foregone. But anyway, as I say, that's another story. I guess that's my punchline. Sometimes Bayesian methods can help. They're an interesting tool in the historian's toolbox. And if anybody can think of a really good situation which is tractable in exactly the way I said on the last slide, then do tell me. We can set Jamie to work. Thank you for your attention. So I'm happy to answer questions. Questions about, before I take the first one, Dogger Bank, Jutland. Because I'm a mathematician, actually, I also run a bachelor's project on forecast verification and probability scoring, which is another reason for that. And also another one on statistical evidence and the law, even though I'm really more of a physicist. So any of those aspects of it, I can perhaps say something interesting about. But anyway, so first question.
What was Churchill's role at this time? What was he running around doing lots of things?
He was in a bunker.
I can't remember, but what I do recall, so something I recall in particular is correspondence between Jellicoe and Churchill. Churchill has a very naive view. Churchill likes big guns. And Jellicoe always says, no, look, you've got a certain tonnage, you can put in guns, propulsion or armour. And you mustn't, because Invincible looks like Dreadnought, that doesn't, you know, you can still see the guns, but what you can't see is the 4-inch armour. Don't, Mr. Churchill, think that a battle cruiser is a battleship. So that's my only comment, actually, about the interaction between what we've been talking about and Churchill. Churchill sort of, I think Churchill would ideally like to be a bit more subtle in his thinking, but his worst self gets the better of him, and he just likes big guns. I think that is...
Did he have something official to do in this?
Oh, yeah. Was he First Lord at that stage?
Yes.
Or was he... And then he went back into the trenches, didn't he? And then he...
He was still First Lord.
Yes. When did he... It was after the Dardanelles. Yeah, so that place is that late 15 or something? I don't think Churchill has any direct involvement. Churchill liked Beatty a lot. There's a story about Churchill being a young war correspondent in the Sudan and an encounter with Beatty jumping ashore off a gunboat, and ever since then Churchill was an admirer of Beatty. Churchill very much likes Beatty's style, which accords with his own. Sorry, but I can't really say more. In fact, I'm sure there are many people in the room who can fill in details of Churchill as First Lord and background to this.
You showed a picture of the Parsons turbine, and I presume it works in a caisson.
Yeah. Oh yes. Yes. That was the actual the guts of the turbine. That was actually from Britannic. The best picture I could find was not from a warship. Sorry.
And what kind of horsepower would you get? I presume they had the fire tube boilers, coal fired.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not competent to answer that. I do recall one anecdote by somebody, I think, on the quarterdeck of Dreadnought, when Dreadnought got underway, saying how amazing it was. You know, they'd been on many ships, and normally with reciprocating engines, you get a hell of a vibrating and juddering and banging, and you know the thing is moving. And that Dreadnought just seemed to just glide off without any noise at all. Sorry, that's just a little anecdote. I can't tell you what the horsepower is of the Parsons turbine at that time and how it relates to the reciprocating engines of the time, which the Germans carried on using for a couple of classes of ships. But somebody at the back maybe can.
Well,
no?
Oh,
no.
I'm going to ask about that. But
okay.
It's a lot of horsepower. In your approach with the Bayesian method, to what extent are you exploring options following major decisions in the cycle of what happened?
Not a lot. Not yet. But we think this is very important. So having talked about it as historical methodology, of course, what you want to understand, if you're to understand the historical actors, is why they thought what they did, whether they were right in thinking what they did, and how, you know, clearly the natural thing after an event is for people to assume it was likely. And unless there's a particular reason to assume it was unlikely, then people modify their behavior on the basis of these things which perhaps we can show were unlikely. So I had the example of the two Naval Institute proceedings articles there. I don't think there's anything very striking for me about the way, so about either the way that a belief that Dogger Bank was likely affected things, except in the Royal Navy complacency. I think they were complacent. The view that it was a victory they should have won, which fitted in with the propaganda approach, was absolutely fine. And so they didn't, well, okay, it's nuanced. I mean, they certainly didn't act a lot to remedy the deficiencies of the ship. There was that Admiralty memorandum urging better flash discipline, which didn't, if I recall correctly, say specifically that it was in the light of experience at Dogger Bank, but was clearly going in the right direction, but perhaps it was doing so a bit half-heartedly, I don't know. The Germans learned the lesson because of the disaster to Seydlitz, and who knows, well, actually who knows, maybe we should, what would have happened to the German battle cruisers at Jutland if they had not improved their flash discipline. And we know German cordite was much more stable than, German and American cordite was more stable than the cordite the British used. On the other hand, they had that fire on Seydlitz, could have happened again. And then going back to the before the battle, now this becomes a matter of historiography, really. Is there anything in the historical literature that would change our views, so historians' views of the actors, now that we know, let me go that far, now that we know that the British got lucky at Dogger Bank? And I don't know of any glaring examples. But these are interesting questions, I think. And certainly for any other example where one were able to do this kind of analysis, I think from the historian's point of view, the interesting things then become the questions about, well, so the actors' judgments in the light of our knowledge about the probability of what happened, and also historians' later judgments. But I'm not really at the moment one of these sort of tertiary historians who, sorry, carry on.
Yes, I was saying there seems to be two aspects of this. If you're modeling before an event or modeling after an event to make decisions. If you're modeling before an event, you have factors which can hardly be considered in the parameters. For example, you mentioned the word luck several times. and the other factor you can't consider is human error.
Well, hang on, luck we can consider. Luck is all. No, the whole message of what I've been saying is that for the last 15 years, across mathematics and statistics, the big growth subject of the last 20 years and for the future, in which Fields medals are now being awarded, is getting a precise mathematical handle on probability, on what are called stochastics.
Well, and yes, but not luck. That's a different thing altogether.
Is it? So,
I think so.
Luck is what? Realised events or unknown unknowns?
No, I'm talking about modelling before the event right now. And the other factor is human error.
So what is luck?
That's a good question. I mean, it's just a totally unanticipated.
Yeah, unknown unknowns, black swans, that kind of
Absolutely
it.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely right.
Yeah.
Unpredictable.
Okay, yes, unknown unknowns. So call them black. To follow Nassim Taleb, call them black swans.
Yeah.
Right. To borrow from Clausewitz, he liked to talk about chance. Right?
Yep.
And my question is, given the influence of people like Fred T. Jane on the method of wargaming, how it was applied here by people like McCarty Little before the First World War, how does the wargaming methodology play out in terms of creating the estimate of the situation before the battles of Dogger Bank and Jutland? And then, given that question, how do the assumptions that are articulated in their estimate play out reacting to things that they hadn't foreseen before engaging in the battle?
I think that the big thing of the 10 years before Dogger Bank was lengthening ranges. And the more the range increases, the more fleet geometry matters, and the commander's job becomes to create the right geometry. So Dogger Bank was fought at ranges far greater than those typically on the tactical board in the Royal Navy before the war. Let me see, I think it's either Custance or Bacon who says that people have tried all sorts of things against me on the gaming board and nobody was ever able to beat a line. But that was at shorter ranges. I don't know of... Okay, most of the papers in the Royal Navy no longer, as far as I know, on gaming, even in the 1920s, don't seem to be extant. It's clear that there was tactical gaming on a tactical level board, but I only have other people's comments in their memoirs, typically, about it. And the one I just gave you is one interesting one. I can't say much about the gaming of the rapid increase in range and thereby the changes in geometry that happened in the 5 years before Dogger Bank. And I don't think anybody else can. If I think of the papers by Sumida, Allen, Garcia, Roberts, lots of them, there's not much on that because I think the papers just aren't there. But the archives material isn't there.
You mentioned in your research here that between the 20s and 40s you had seen a lot of confusion about how to come up with this effective model, how to write it into the rules of the war game. I'm just wondering if you have any ideas at this point of what was causing so much of that confusion and what was the difficulty in doing it.
Well, there's one particular point which, so this is a sort of a simple but a mathematical point that I'd need to explain on a board about. Okay, so the result of damage being caused in proportion to numbers is what's called Lanchester's square law. If anybody's heard of that, basically you have to get the idea that there are two things going on. There's what happens instantaneously and there's what happens over the course of a battle. If you're doing a tactical game, you're interested in what happens in one move, so instantaneously. If you cause damage in proportion to numbers instantaneously, then the result as you integrate, is the calculus word, but sum that up over the course of the battle, is that the side wins, which has the greater... Okay, so a side's capacity to win depends on, is in proportion to the square of its numbers, but that's a summing effect over the course of the battle. Now, just looking through the War College's gaming rules, there's a point that I'm finding rather interesting. When Reeves was head of tactics in 1924 to 25, in the big tactical games of those 2 years, when they say in the maneuver rules that if you've got fighting between two forces of patrol or fighter aircraft, that the umpires will decide, so there's no formal rule, the umpires will decide what the outcome is, but that the fighting strength of the two forces is in proportion to the square of its numbers. And that's a terrible, terrible error, because remember the square is what happens over the whole course of the battle. At an instant, effectively the damage should be just in proportion to numbers, not their square. And then you can trace that through the wargaming right through to 1946. By 1941, they've started implementing the Lanchester's rule correctly, that each side in each move causes damage in proportion to its numbers. There's a 2 year gap in 1944 and 45 for some reason. And then in 1946, they've got a slightly nuanced and different rule, which is no longer quite the Lanchester rule. But in another body of work, which I've done with my colleagues, we pretty much decided that I think we've shown from the historical data, certainly from the data of the Pacific Air War, that the Lanchester rule that each side caused damage in proportion to its numbers is wrong anyway. So the danger is that in all the wargaming, there is a greater emphasis or value placed on numbers of planes together in the air at one time. And of course you could argue that actually unintended consequences that had a revolutionary positive effect. I mean, I'm just forming these ideas in the US Navy because of the ability to the pushing of carrier aviation in the United States in the interwar period. Of course, you also have Moffat in charge of the Bureau of Aeronautics and all sorts of other factors. But certainly the impressive significance of aircraft and the importance of making sure that bomber and torpedo and observation aircraft were accompanied by fighters in the air to ensure control over the air was probably exaggerated by the games. On the other hand, it's probably a very good thing that it was. Now, as you can tell, I'm beginning to, your eyes are glazing over a little bit, I'm beginning to download lots of my thoughts on this. There's quite a lot to be said. And I'm sure that there are plenty of people who could look at rules for current war games. So I've just spent some time, as you know, at the postgraduate school, and I know some of them come over here to do annual gigs on combat modeling. So use the intelligence of those guys. Just you can look over the actual game rules and the instantaneous game rules and make sure that they're reasonable, and that would be a very well worthwhile thing to do, I think. And maybe everything is just much better now. If we take a Whiggish view of history, then I assume that the rules nowadays are just all perfect and everything's absolutely fine and the black box doesn't need to be examined. Whereas back in those days, those are just old-fashioned people, they knew nothing. So. Somebody else.
I'll give you a full disclosure. I'm from the wargaming department here.
Okay.
And when you say the model is wrong and it, there is a simulation that is not necessarily accurate, I mean, all models are wrong, some are useful.
Yeah.
There are several levels of wargaming, some of which, like campaign analysis, has a series of inputs, the black box, and a series of outputs. There are other types of gaming. Analytic gaming is a little bit higher level. That's the question I asked about decision making. It doesn't really matter. It matters to a certain extent, obviously, but it is not necessary for the models of engagement, the probability of kill, probability of detection, to be super precise.
Yep, I accept that.
All you have to be is accurate, because the games that are of the most interest, and there's some work done here, Al Mofi's book on the interwar games here is fascinating.
I've got that open on my desk at the moment.
Yeah. But the real value of the games at the level of the analytic game is when the outcome is determined, what decision do you make and why?
Yeah, sure.
You know, how do you view your force ratios? How do you view your relative combat power? So, you know, we tend to, especially in the computer age, because processing is so much easier now than it was, we tend to get focused on, is this a 0.7 or a 0.67, you know, probability of hit, probability of kill? It doesn't really matter. It's an effective missile. It does its job. If you are in its envelope, what decisions do you make? So I just offer that out there.
No, absolutely. And I guess a couple of thoughts. First of all, 0.67 versus 0.7, you don't care about. But you do want to know what the cogs in the black box are doing.
Absolutely.
They might be important. Mm-hmm. I agree absolutely that these details matter much less at the higher and more analytic level, just as long as nobody's making any false assumptions or inappropriate assumptions in force planning.
Nobody ever does that in wargaming.
So I shouldn't overstate the significance of that imbalance, but at least it worked in the right direction. If it had worked in a different direction, it might have caused a different course of construction in the United States Navy between the wars, maybe. I don't know. Maybe it wouldn't have done. Maybe Moffat would always, and Moffat and Reeves would always have made their points and it would have been okay. I don't know. That one is a wildly ramified bit of history which we can't model using Bayesian computation, I think.
Anything else?
It sounds as though your fire control equipment was not up to the Germans.
No, I think the German fire control equipment on, I might be a bit out of my depth here, on Seydlitz, they was absolutely out of control. And of course, there was a case on Lion at Jutland, where the major in charge of the turret, basically flooded the turret, thus killing himself and the remainder of his crew, but saving the ship. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know enough about German fire control. Sorry, by fire control, you mean fire...
Well, the ability to fire at a target...
Oh, sorry, okay, you mean direct... Okay, so for director firing, the Germans had better... Well, better optics, basically. The British... There's been a long controversy over what we could call analog computers should be used. The Argo clock, which was a particular form of rangefinder fitted to the dryer table, this sort of stuff. Actually, the British had... pretty effective director firing, certainly on the battleships, and certainly on the battleships that were fitted with the Argo clock. The Germans tended more to fire independently, but they fired better and they had good optics. I think that's probably the most significant thing, as far as I know, but somebody else may know better than me. So I thought you meant damage control.
Did any of these theories change when, like in the late 30s, early 40s, when the German pocket battleships broke up? The gas spray, etc.
Which theories? What?
Well, this Lancaster theory.
The Lancaster theory.
The modeling. Because those battleships really, those pocket battleships really tore it up for a. As far as
yeah, I'm not sure. I see the connection really between. I mean, the Germans built what they could, and you could make an argument that the pocket battleships were not well conceived. In that they.
The German side or the British side?
On the German side, I think. I mean, as commerce raiders, of course, they were good, but so would anything have been.
Yeah.
In terms of the forces they were likely to meet, they were constructed within the constraints on German construction in the 30s, and that perhaps was more significant. You know, that was the real constraint rather than what they would have wished to build. I don't think there's much to do with the Lancaster models there. Anyway, I guess we should probably. I'm happy to talk to anybody else who wants.
I was just going to say, you couldn't hardly apply that theory to the Battle of Britain, for example, where the.
Sorry, you could.
You couldn't apply it to the Battle of Britain, the theory of numbers and multiplication thereof, to predict an outcome. I mean, because the relative numbers were quite out of balance. The Germans had a far larger fleet. By the way, you can see the problem.
Well, hang on, you're interested in sortie numbers, and sortie numbers as a time series. Day by day, and in fact we've got four papers on that now. So if you're interested, please feel free to have a look at the literature on the Battle of Britain.
In essence, what are you saying as an answer? Sorry,
what am I saying?
In essence, was your answer to that?
Well, you talk about the Germans having a larger force, and that there was more imbalance in numbers. Imbalance in numbers is precisely what enables you to test Lancaster assumptions. And also, when you're testing it, you're interested in forces engaged.
Right.
So really, you're interested in comparing loss rates with sorties flown. And because you can do that day by day, and to a large extent, one day is much like another, and in fine weather, one place is much like another, although one height is not like another, you have some homogeneity in the time series data, which enables you to, some stationarity in the time series data, which enables you to conduct an analysis much more effectively than you ever can of land and all arms war, where you know people have made various attempts to test Lancaster and related models, and they usually come to nothing, essentially foundering on the variability of the conditions underlying the data.
Yeah.
I think. But as I say, if you're interested in the Battle of Britain, we've got both quantified and narrative history papers.
When England started, got into World War II, did they have the same World War I firepower and equipment? Because the battleship Hood was built in 1918, and she lasted one salvo from the German ship Prince Eugen.
Yeah, I mean, as Rangers opened out, there was a crucial story about how much you armoured a deck. And there are, if you think as the range closes in, you're vulnerable in different ways to different sorts of fire as things close in. Hood was passing through so Bismarck's shooting was excellent, but so you know second salvo I think it was she scored a hit. But Hood was passing through a zone at which she knew she was vulnerable because she was basically an old super battle cruiser to which extra armour had been added, but not. I think it's still fair to say not enough armour. Now. There is a test to be done, a sort of question. Was Hood desperately unlucky or not? That's quite a tricky question to answer, but in principle, well, the trouble is that there was only one hood. So you don't have good data on the parameters, really. You can estimate, you can come up with priors, but they'll have nothing like the strength of the ones that you get for the First World War battle cruisers from Dogger Bank and Jutland.
We have luck again.
Unknown unknowns. Well, no, I think the unknown unknowns are pretty. You know what Hood's potential vulnerabilities are, and so do her captain. So does anybody who's.
Decks, but they never got to finish the time.
Sorry.
They tried to rebuild her deck.
Yes.
Before deck, but they never got finished the time.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Anyway, I think we've probably spent enough time.
All right.
So thank you very much.
Thank you.